Good evening. My name is Hortense Crozier Perfect, and I will be your moderator for this evening's class. Welcome to the Institute of Divine Metaphysical Research. This is a school and not a church. Neither are we affiliated with any religious organizations. This school is a nonprofit, non-denominational, religious and scientific research organization dedicated to showing proof of the existence of Yahweh or Elohim and the operation of his eternal purpose, pattern, and plan operating throughout eternity to this present day. This school was established as a result of a divine vision and divine revelation given to our founder, Dr. Henry Clifford Kinley, in the state of Ohio in the year 1931. We were incorporated in the state of California in the year 1958. We hold classes in the United States, Canada, and certain other foreign countries. The Ontario branch was established in May of 1988. At this time, I would like to introduce our Dean, Dr. Marlon Love, and our President, Dr. Christopher Wim. In this school, we use the true, correct, and original name and title of the Father, the Word or Son, and the Holy Spirit, which are contained in the original Hebrew text. The true name of our Heavenly Father is Yahweh. It has been improperly substituted with Lord. The true title of the Word or Son is Elohim. It has been improperly substituted with God. The name of the Holy Spirit, manifested in or out of a physical body, is Yahshua. It has been erroneously substituted with Jesus Christ. Lord and God are titles and not names. The Apostle Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, tells us in 1 Corinthians 8 and 5 that there are Lords many and God's many. But we now know that each Lord must have a name and each God must have a name also. Elohim is a title, but unlike Lord and God, Elohim is a divine title. That means that Elohim is the title that our Creator chose for himself. Jesus is a name, but it is an erroneous name. A minor investigation on your part in any good dictionary or encyclopedia would prove that neither the Hebrew, Greek, or Latin languages have any characters or letters in their alphabet that would produce the sound that is made by this letter J. Neither was there a letter J in our English language until some 1400 years after the Messiah's death. Therefore, such names as Jesus and Jehovah are impossible renderings of the true and original name of our Father and his Son. Christ is a title, just like Lord and God. Yahweh is pure spirit, and in this state, he is incomprehensible and inscrutable. He is the ultimate source, substance, the limits and bounds of everything. We have Yahweh in his pure spirit state, symbolized on this chart as a cloud. Yahweh is not a cloud. He merely chose a cloud to symbolize himself because a cloud has no particular or descriptive shape or form. We have drawn this cloud all around the edges of this chart to show you that everything on this chart is within the cloud. In like manner, everything in the universe abides within the pure spirit state of Yahweh. Yahweh, knowing that man could not perceive of him in his pure spirit shape, took on shape and form right within himself as Elohim. This is the Word or Son, a superincorporeal being, that is having the shape and form of a man, but without flesh and blood. This shape and form can only be seen in divine visions and understood in divine revelations. Later on, this self-same spirit manifested himself in a physical body and walked the earth plane as Yahshua the Messiah, whom the world calls Jesus Christ. Now there is only one name given unto salvation, and we must know that name. So the simple yet intelligent question we should all ask ourselves is, what was the name of the Savior during the time he walked the earth plane? A further understanding of this name and title can be had by reading the preface of the Holy Name Bible. Also in this school, we teach about the divine pattern of the universe. It is called the divine pattern because it is Yahweh's pattern. After Yahweh led the children of Israel out of Egypt, he called Moses atop Mount Sinai, and he showed him the tabernacle pattern in a vision. Yahweh instructed Moses to build one exactly like it in the wilderness of Sinai. The pattern consists of a most holy place, and a court roundabout. These three compartments make up the one tabernacle pattern. In the school, we show proof that everything in the universe is made and operates according to the structure and function of this threefold tabernacle pattern, and that absolutely nothing escapes the pattern. The 10 primary constitutional objectives and aims of the Institute are as follows. First, to help you find and know Yahweh, or Elohim, as he really is and actually exists. Second, to form a nucleus of universal brotherhood of humanity in Yahshua the Messiah, without distinction of race or nationality, creed, sex, caste, or color. Third, to investigate the unexplained spirit law, or so-called law of nature, and the powers latent in man. Fourth, to encourage and promote the study of the scriptures, comparative religions, psychology, philosophy, and modern practical and occult science. Fifth, to extirpate current superstition, skepticism, and ignorance. Sixth, to learn, know, and understand the operation of Yahweh's eternal purpose through the dispensation and ages. Seventh, to discern and avoid being deceived by Lucifer, the serpent, the devil, the dragon, or Satan, and his demons, operating the mystery of iniquity on earth through the dispensations of time. Eighth, to earnestly contend for the common salvation and faith which was once delivered to the sons or children of Yahweh. Ninth, to make known that Yahweh, from the beginning, ordained there is no other name given among men whereby man can be saved, saving the name of Yahshua the Messiah. Tenth, to inherit eternal life now in the kingdom of Yahshua the Messiah with the hope of immortal glorification in the new earth state. Our watchword is peace, and our slogan is speak the truth. We will now have a prayer by Dr. Bud Winch, followed by a selection of music. Our scripture lesson is Romans, the 15th chapter, and that will be read by Dr. Lynette Gill.
The night of class. Thank you, Father. Let us all say hallelujah.
Good evening, class.
Good evening.
My name is Nanette Ramirez, and I'll be reading out of the Holy Name Bible containing the Holy Name versions of the Old and New Testaments, critically compared with ancient authorities and various manuscripts, revised by the late A.B. Traina, the Scripture Research Association. I'll be reading Romans, the 15th chapter. We then that are strong ought to bear the infirmities of the weak, and not to please ourselves. Let every one of us please his neighbor for his good to edification. For even the Messiah pleased not himself, but as it is written, the reproaches of them that reproach thee fell on me. For whatsoever things were written aforetime were written for our learning, that we through patience and comfort of the scriptures might have hope. Now the Elohim of patience and consolation grant you to be like-minded one toward another according to the example of Yahshua the Messiah, that ye may with one mind and one mouth glorify Yahweh, even the Father of our Savior Yahshua the Messiah. Wherefore, receive ye one another as the Messiah also received us to the glory of Yahweh. Now I say that Yahshua the Messiah was a minister of the circumcision for the truth of Yahweh, to confirm the promises made unto the fathers, and that the nations might glorify Yahweh for his mercy. As it is written, for this cause I will confess to thee among the nations, and sing unto thy name. And again he saith, rejoice, ye nations, with his people. And again, praise Yahweh, all ye nations, and laud him, all ye people. And again, Isaiah saith, there shall be a root of Jesse, and he that shall rise to reign over the nations, in him shall the nations trust. Now the Elohim of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, that ye may abound in hope through the power of the Holy Spirit. And I myself also am persuaded of you, my brethren, that ye also are full of goodness, filled with all knowledge, able also to admonish one another. Nevertheless, brethren, I have written the more boldly unto you in some sort, as putting you in mind because of the grace that is given to me of Yahweh, that I should be the minister of Yahshua the Messiah to the nations, ministering the gospel of Yahweh, that the offering up of the nations might be acceptable, being sanctified by the Holy Spirit. I have therefore, whereof I may glory through Yahshua the Messiah in those things which pertain to Yahweh. For I will not dare to speak of any of those things which the Messiah hath not wrought by me, to make the nations obedient by word and deed, through my mighty signs and wonders, by the power of the Spirit of Yahweh, so that from Jerusalem and round about unto Illyricum, I have fully preached the evangel of the Messiah. Yea, so have I strived to preach the evangel where the Messiah was not known, lest I should build upon another man's foundation. But as it is written, to whom he was not spoken of, they shall see. And they that have not heard shall understand. For which cause also I have been many times hindered from coming to you. But now having no more place in these parts, and having a great desire these many years to come unto you, whensoever I take my journey into Spain, I will come to you, for I trust to see you in my journey, and to be brought on my way thitherward by you, having first enjoyed your company. But now I go unto Jerusalem to minister unto the sons, for it hath pleased them of Macedonia and Achaia to make a certain contribution for the poor sons which are at Jerusalem. It hath pleased them verily, and their debtors they are. For if other nations have been made partakers of their spiritual things, their duty is also to minister unto them in carnal things. When therefore I have performed this, and have sealed to them this fruit, I will come by you into Spain. And I am sure that when I come unto you, I shall come in the fullness of the blessing of the gospel of the Messiah. Now I beseech you, brethren, for the Savior Yahshua, the Messiah's sake, and for the love of the Spirit, that ye strive together with me in your prayers to Yahweh for me, that I may be delivered from them that do not believe in Judea, and that my service which I have for Jerusalem may be accepted by the sons, that I may come unto you with joy by the will of Yahweh, and may with you be refreshed. Now the Elohim of peace be with you all. I have read Romans the 15th chapter. Let us all say hallelujah.
Thank you, Dr. Lynette Ramirez and Dr. Bud Rent. This evening is Thursday, our open testimony night, our lecture night. So if anyone would like to give a testimony, either in class or on Zoom, now is the time. If there is no one, I would like to call on our first speaker, Dr. Lynette Ramirez.
I'm not sure where it's at, that scripture, just to have it read, that Yahweh is spirit and we must worship him. Yes.
For Yahweh is spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth.
Right? Yeah. What scripture is that again?
John 4:24.
Okay, so that's John 4:24.
I can start it further.
Yeah, go ahead.
23. But the hour cometh, and now is, when the true worshipers shall worship the Father in spirit and in truth. For the Father seeketh to worship him. For Yahweh is spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth.
Okay, so right there that says there's nothing that we could physically do with our hands or anything to worship Yahweh. We have to worship him in spirit and in truth. So this right here, these carnal ordinances are no longer valid. They were never for us to perform. They were given to the Hebrew people or the children of Israel at the time when they crossed the Red Sea and went to worship Yahshua or Yahweh at the mountain, at Mount Sinai, and they're given those commandments as a as a form of a like a contract of marriage, I could say. For lack of a better word, I can't remember the word that I was going to say. So those commandments were given to the children of Israel, or how we say the Jews and the Jews only. They were not given to the Gentiles, and not given to us, you know, in the future either as well. And can we get the scripture that says what the New Testament that is written in our hearts and minds, that Hebrews 8 and 10?
Colossians 2:14.
Okay.
Colossians 2:14. Blotting out the handwritings of ordinances that was against us, which was contrary to us, and took it out of the way, nailing it to his cross.
Okay. So right there it explains about the fulfillment of these cardinal ordinances and all of this, the statutes, and well, the law. So let's get Hebrews 8 and 10. That might.
Okay. Hebrews 8 and 10.
Is that
9 and 10? Okay, let me start. Not according to the covenant that I made with their fathers in the day when I took them by the hand to lead them out of the land of Egypt, because they continue not in my covenant, and I regarded them not, said Yahweh. But this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, said Yahweh. I will put my laws into their mind and write them in their hearts, and I will be to them their Elohim, and they shall be to me my people.
Okay, so right there it says, you know, that's going to be the new covenant in our hearts and minds. Now, we know that he's not talking about the physical Jew or the physical children of Israel back then. He's talking about the spiritual Jew. So let's get that scripture that talks about the spiritual Jew that, I can't remember where it's at.
He's not a Jew outwardly.
Yes, that one. Inwardly. That one.
Okay, Romans 2:28. Let's see. For he is not a Jew, which is one outwardly, neither that circumcision, which is outward in the flesh. But he is a Jew, which is one inwardly, and circumcision is that of the heart and in the spirit, and not in the letter, whose praise is not of men, but of Yahweh.
Right. So right there explains that we must be, we will be circumcised in our hearts, and it's pertaining to the spiritual Jew, not the physical Jew. So That's all I have for tonight. If anyone got anything out of those few words, all praises belong to Yahweh, our Elohim, through Yahshua the Messiah. Let us all say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Dr. Lynette Ramirez. That was good. I would now like to call on the Dean of the Ontario Branch, Dr. Marlon Love.
Good evening, class.
Good evening.
It's good to be here. And once again, to learn more perfectly about Yahweh's purpose, pattern, and plan. I thoroughly enjoyed the first vessel and the things that they had to say, that they've come to learn and know since being in this school. And it's not easy, once again, to stand in front of the assembly of Yahshua the Messiah, because although we're not critiquing, we're listening and we're all learning. No big I's, no little U's. Sometimes that's one may think there is, but it's not, because we're vessels. And every vessel has a purpose, has a particular way of delivering their message, or the message. It's not their message, but the message. Sure. Let me make that clear. There's stumbling things that we have to learn to discern, and we're not perfect. But in the sense that I also want to apologize for the sound being off momentarily in the discourse. See, these things happen, you see, and we have to be patient with one another. That's you know, right. We don't have a full audience, if you would, or a sound crew, if you would. You know, we put this thing together the best we know how to. Our sound tech is not always here to push all the right buttons. But yet, being a student, we have to be patient. And that's what part of our scripture reading that Saul spoke about, as far as having patience with one another and being able to edify one another with the gospel, not with your opinion, not with your likes and dislikes, if you would. You follow? So these things we have to begin to absorb and to apply. Just as we've said before, this chart does take our picture. Most definitely. Once one learns and understands how this chart is put together and what it's showing, it's taking our picture. Because we start off in Egypt. That means not knowing anything about Yahshua the Messiah. We already ought to know that you're not going to learn anything about Yahweh in his pure spirit state. You follow? Christendom has that same philosophy. You're not going to know nothing about God until you die. You see, we're not taking that frame of mind, you follow? Romans 1:19 and 20, 1:19 particularly. Let me make my point clear. We say you're not going to know anything about Yahweh in this pure spirit state and condition. Yet we say that Yahweh is intelligence, wisdom, and knowledge, love, beauty, justice, power, foundation, and strength. These attributes make up, and many others, Yahweh. You know something about Yahweh. You follow? But let's see what Romans, Saul says to the Romans pertaining to this.
Romans 1:19. Mm-hmm. Because that which may be known of Yahweh manifest.
Hold up. What did he say?
That which may be known of Yahweh.
That's it. That's what I wanted to say. We said it sounds like a contradiction. Not gonna know nothing about Yahweh in this pure spirit state and condition.
Yeah.
But in the moderation, if you listen to the moderation, and again that was muted for one moment. But yeah, we say it in every class. Yahweh knew that we weren't going to understand him in this pure spirit state and condition. Therefore, it behooved Yahweh in order to transform and transmute into this super incorporeal being known as Elohim.
Right.
You follow? This being the Word or Son, Yahweh in this state and condition. You follow? Later on, if you read your Bible, it talks about there in John 1 and 1 that this word was with Yahweh. That's letting you know that this word was Yahweh and is Yahweh. Let's go ahead and grab that. Let's make that
John very 1 clear. And 1.
Uh-huh.
In the beginning was the Word.
Okay.
And the Word was with Yahweh.
Uh-huh.
And the Word was Yahweh.
Right there. I just got done saying that this Word was Yahweh. It is Yahweh. It's not another being.
Right.
You follow? It's not another created anything. He, in part, he, Yahweh, in this pure spirit state, in part, not in totality, meaning if we were to run the Acts and Saul again talking to those on Mars Hill, talking about we live, move, and have our being within Yahweh. You follow? Yeah. There in 17th chapter, correct, around the 28th verse, I believe. Mm-hmm. That's the statement that John's making. And remember, Saul is making, this is after Pentecost, whereby that's when the Holy Spirit, Yahweh, in that state and condition, went into the hearts and minds of man. Just as Nanette talked about, what is the new covenant? The new covenant is not written in a book.
That's right.
That fly leaf in people's Bible is not the New Testament. Mm-hmm. You follow? She went through and touched on what that New Testament was. Okay. It is when this veil, if you would, as she made mention about,
right,
is ripped in twain. And an understanding about Yahweh begins to form in you. It begins to take nature. It circumcises the egotistical, misdirected personality of what you once were before you knew anything about Yahweh. Because remember, it got Yahweh on this figure, it has Elohim on this figure, and it also has Yahshua on this figure. Mm-hmm. Yahshua is not merely this man 2,000 years ago on this cross. Yahshua, as we have on the name board and that we show in the moderation on the names, that's the Holy Spirit. And that spirit has been expressed either in the body or out of the body. At the then known time, when Yahshua the Messiah walked the earth plane, known as Yahshua the Messiah, because that's the question in the moderation, that's the question that people should be asking,
right,
about who was that man,
yeah,
and what was his name. Mm-hmm. And we're letting you know that man's name was Yahshua the Messiah. Mm-hmm. You follow? In a body. In a specially prepared body, if you would. Grab me Isaiah 53, please. And I think we can start at 1.
Isaiah 53 and 1. Who hath believed our report?
Mm-hmm.
To whom is the arm of Yahweh revealed?
Look, this arm or this report got to be revealed to somebody. This is Isaiah. Mm-hmm. This is part of the testimony or the prophets that's talking about this Yahweh.
Right.
Prophesying that this Yahweh has an arm and a report that's going to reach out and touch somebody in their consciousness and in their understanding about who Yahweh is. You follow? Keep reading.
For he shall grow up before him as a tender plant,
mm-hmm,
and as a root out of a dry ground.
Mm-hmm.
He hath no form,
mm-hmm,
nor comeliness.
That's right.
And when we shall see him, there is no beauty that we should desire him.
So you're going to be able to see him. Now, that's the prophet Isaiah talking about one Yahshua the Messiah. It's not going to be becoming. It's not going to be anything special. He's specially prepared to be in this body in order to perform the works that he came in to work. Now, the question is, what did he come in to do? Mm-hmm. Why did he come in this specially prepared body, not only that he's going to be hung on a cross like an outcast dog, and be crucified. It wasn't nothing. It wasn't nothing like he was trying to plan for retirement or be around no long time or just teach until he didn't fall over. He was only 33 and a half years old when he took off that flesh. You follow? Mm-hmm. Now, that purpose of Yahshua, the Messiah, was as what Nanette talked about. You see, we understand that they were the children of people that were specially prepared. We have that a peculiar people. I think Exodus something. Peculiar. Because we're talking about Yahshua the Messiah coming in a body, a specially prepared body. A body that's destined for crucifixion, for death. And he's coming in for these people, as it were, as we read this book. I think it's peculiar. You find it?
1 Peter 2:9, I
think. That sounds right.
1 Peter?
Yeah. Peter talks about it.
Okay.
Thank you, Doc. Look at you. You know where it's at. 1 Peter 2:9.
Right.
I think.
Yeah, that's one place.
Hold on,
though. One place.
Yeah, go ahead and go with it.
Okay. But ye
started,
are...
Started, yeah, let's start at one.
One.
Because we're talking about Yahshua the Messiah. Nanette expressed about a circumcision and about a law, about Yahweh putting a law in our inward parts and circumcising our concepts, theories, and opinions about who he is. Because as it's been expressed in John 17 chapter, that life eternal is to know about Yahweh, Yahshua, in order to know something about our Heavenly Father. Okay? So we got to know, and even Yahshua himself says there in Matthew, the 11th chapter, down towards the end there, he also says, take his yoke upon you and learn of him. You follow? But then the question then poses, what are we learning about him? You follow? See, when I had asked the question, number one, in the moderation, it talks about, well, who was this man that walked the earth plane? It was a question.
Mm-hmm.
Why did he come as a specially prepared body, as Isaiah talked about there in the 53rd chapter of Isaiah? Why did he come? All right? And what's this purpose of all this? And then he talks about a book or some scriptures that he says is all about him, not you
right.
or not me.
Right.
You follow? That we need to be able to be mindful of and wonder what scriptures are he talking about. And he's referring to the only thing that they had, they being those Jews that were in Jerusalem, were reading at the then known time, which was the law and the prophets, which were the texts that we have in our Old Testament of the Bible.
Mm-hmm.
You follow? That's what constitutes the scriptures. These are the scriptures that Yahshua is talking about there in John 5 and 39. I'm not going to have it read. I've said it. John 5 and 39 lets you know that Yahshua asked them, ye search the scriptures, and in them ye think you have eternal life. Now he's talking to those Jews at the then known time. You follow? And then what they had were the first five books of Moses, which constitutes the Torah, or the Pentateuch, if you would. Then he has the subsequent 34 books of the prophets, from Joshua all the way down to Malachi. That's what they had. That's what they read. That's what they put all over their houses, all over themselves, the priests that were, that as it were. You follow? Those are these carnal ordinances that Nanette talked about earlier. These carnal ordinances. There's not only 10, there's 613 judgments, statutes, and ordinances by which those people were reading about. You follow? Now, this is Yahshua. This is what we're learning about Yahshua. This is what they had at the then known time. You follow? And why we're learning about Yahshua is because people are still trying to follow the law. They think that this carnal ordinances or this law are for everybody to follow because they say Jesus told me so.
Yeah.
You see? Now, in their reading of Jesus telling them so, that's what they think. But Yahshua didn't say that. Yahshua said he come to fulfill.
Yeah, he did.
You follow? These things for these people because these people were going to be an example for the whole world to be able to follow. Let's start with Peter a little bit. And this is Peter after his conversion, after his veil was rent in twain. Because remember, he was a disciple of Yahshua for 3.5 years. Then on the day of Pentecost, 50 days after the outpouring of the Holy Spirit came into his heart and mind, as Nanette talked about, that Yahweh was going to put his law or that second covenant into one's heart and mind. Peter has it. Peter's writing about it now, writing to his people. Read.
1 Peter 2:1.
He's writing to those people that know something about Yahshua the Messiah. They don't know about no Jesus. There's no J in the Hebrew language, then or now. Therefore, Peter's not talking about Jesus. He's talking about Yahshua the Messiah, which is his name. Read.
Wherefore, laying aside all malice and all guile and hypocrisy and envies and all evil speaking.
See, all that is pertaining to these carnal ordinances. This is what they got them all confused and talking, beguiling and tricking and judging one another over this law. Mm-hmm. This is what Peter's talking to his people about. Read.
As newborn babes desire the sincere milk of the word.
Now Peter's telling his people to desire the sincere milk of the word. Not of the scriptures. Not of what they think they think it's about, mm-hmm. what they're bickering over. He said, hey, as babes, mm-hmm. Yahshua the Messiah said, hey, none going to enter the kingdom of heaven unless ye become like little children. Huh? Yeah. And learn again. And become mm-hmm. born again. Learn again. That's all the born again we're talking about because old Nick, you know, when Nick went to Yahshua the Messiah by night, creeping in, thinking he going to get some information because he know that he is from Elohim of all the things that he's done. And what he was talking about, how he was talking about. Even Nick didn't know how you're going to be born again. And we're letting you know is to be mm-hmm. educated or to be knowledgeable of Yahshua the Messiah. That's how you're becoming born again, like newborn babes, as Peter's expressing to them. Because this is just the start of it. In that fifth dispensation, when that Holy Spirit kicked in, and now he's beginning to speak
right.
about Yahshua. Before then, Peter didn't have nothing to say. Peter denied the Messiah 3 times.
He
didn't know nothing. Nobody knew nothing about Yahshua the Messiah. Nothing about the purpose of Yahshua the Messiah until the day of Pentecost. And that Pentecost is still going on if you believe the long arm of Yahweh. We had just read it in Isaiah. And the report of Yahweh about Yahweh through his son, Yahshua the Messiah. And Peter tells them what?
That ye may grow thereby.
You'll grow You're going to have patience. You're going to have growing pains. You're going to make mistakes, as we did tonight. No different. There's not a miracle pill like you got on that movie, the red pill, the blue pill. You're just going to become it. It don't work like that.
Yeah, true that.
Keep reading.
True that. Since ye have tasted that the Savior is gracious.
See, they tasted. They ain't taste them. They tasted the word. They tasted the gospel. They've heard the gospel preached to them like milk. Don't believe it? Isaiah 28, 9, and 10, please. Like milk. See, and someone had to be taught about how to deliver the milk. Let's see if that's so. Isaiah. Because you got to go to the law and got to the prophets. Mm-hmm. If you're not speaking according to that word, which was Yahshua the Messiah, writing through those men at the then known time about what he's coming to do. And this is something that they wrote pertaining to Yahshua the Messiah. Read.
Whom shall he teach knowledge?
Whom shall Yahshua the Messiah teach knowledge?
And whom shall he make to understand doctrine?
Now you got to be made to understand doctrine. When you're making something to understand doctrine, meaning you got to contend. You're not going to be right off of Jump Street. Someone, Yahshua the Messiah, or the Holy Spirit, right, is going to have to make you to understand doctrine. You're just not going to know it lickety-split. Keep reading.
Them that are weaned from the milk
right
and
there.
Drawn from the breast.
Them that are weaned from the milk. So Peter's not talking about anything that Peter's talking about. Peter's talking about what Isaiah's talking about.
Right.
He's drawn out from the prophets about this milk that they've licked by hearing the gospel of Yahshua the Messiah. That's what they're licking. That's what they licked. That's what they consumed. That was the milk that Peter had been made to understand. That's why Peter's talking. That's why Peter rose up on the day of Pentecost and preached the gospel of Yahshua Messiah to those souls at the then known time. Beginning in Jerusalem first. That means Pentecost didn't just roll out like a fog and land on everybody. That's not what we're talking about. We're talking about a gospel that has to be preached by someone that's been made to preach the gospel. How to deliver the milk to babes. Peter had talked about babes right there, back there in Peter, right? He talked about the babes.
Right.
And you get baby milk, typically. Why? Because it's easy to digest. It's easy to accept. You see? See, it's hard for people to get off this Jesus. Labeling him as Jesus and thinking that this cross symbol is going to do them a bit of good. It's hard to get someone off of this image.
Yeah.
Hard to get someone to realize that that letter J is an erroneous letter in Hebrew, Greek, and Latin. Because they had it written up here. In all three, we just have it in one. This is the Latin. And they didn't write Jesus on here either. They subsequently took that Y-N-R-Y for Yahuda and not Jews. You see, that's a symbol for a J. Because that's where the J derives from, was that I. When you backtrack and look at that genealogies or the etymology, they say, of letters or of words. You follow? So this is really Yahshua of Nazareth, king of the Jews. And they wrote that three times upon his head, above his head, at the then known time. It's hard to get people off of thinking that that's Jesus. They walk around with I-N-R-I, but they miss the whole point about what his name is. And therefore, you got to give them milk. We got to go to the dictionary. We got to go to the encyclopedia. Maybe we can find it somewhere on Google and let you know that that letter J is only about 400 years old. And then we got to begin to teach you about the name of how he come in his father's name, scripture here and scripture here, a little bit at a time, so that hopefully it'll digest and become part of the system. You follow? What else in Isaiah? The milk.
For Mm-hmm. Precept must be upon precept.
Precept is forever, enduring. That's a principle that lies throughout time. Read.
Don't change. Precept upon precept, line upon line, line upon line.
See, people don't know where that line is. And that has to be taught. And we, being teachers, have to have shown what the line is, what that milk is. You see? A little bit at a time. Now let's go back to Peter, since we got what that milk is. You follow? Mm-hmm. It's not just milk. Not low-fat milk. It's not oat milk. It's not no soybean milk. There's no milk involved with it. I'm speaking literally like that because people take him as being in the sky, because they take what they've read literally so. So I'm not joking around about the types of milk. I'm joking around letting you know that that milk is the gospel. Mm-hmm. Precept upon precept, line upon line. Right. And a person has to be taught and made to understand that. And that person has to be willing to accept that. Otherwise, you're just reading around in the Bible and it becomes a storyboard for you.
Just like Moses did eat and drink while he was up in the mountain.
Yep. There's a specific statement that would be made about Moses and the children of Israel. Here, when they had this vision, and when Moses by Yahshua the Messiah called Moses into this mount, they saw and they did eat and drink. You follow? But they didn't learn nothing. They didn't realize nothing about what they saw. It wasn't time yet. But see, by the gospel, now having been poured out, we can express what they saw, why they saw it at the then known time. You follow? Letting us know that Elohim is a being that can be seen. Just like we read there in Romans 1 and 19, that Yahweh can be seen. You follow? Because they saw him there in the wilderness. 74 people saw him there in the wilderness, sure enough, right? And they ate and drank, but it wasn't time yet for them to understand the precepts and the principles by which Yahshua Messiah came in to do. Now, Peter's going to talk about it a little bit. About that milk.
For to whom coming as unto a living stone, disallowed indeed of men, but chosen of Yahweh and precious,
mm-hmm.
ye also as lively stones are built up a spiritual house.
Now look, he's talking about lively stone because Yahshua was a stone by which his gospel was going to be preached on. Now we got a stone here that Daniel writes about in the second chapter of Daniel, 45th verse, talking about this stone. Just grab that right quick, since we got to go a little bit slow, because we're talking about life. He just got done saying stones to them. You follow? And that's not just Roman people. He's talking about the Jews that were in Rome. He's talking to a specific people.
Daniel, 2:44. Okay. And in the days of these kings shall the Lord of heaven set up a kingdom.
Now look, in the days of these kings, these are kingdoms, Babylon, Medes, Persia, Grecia, Rome. These are going to be all these kings here. And Yahweh or Elohim is going to do what? Read.
Elohim of heaven set up a kingdom,
uh-huh.
which shall never be destroyed.
Now, there's going to be a kingdom that's never going to be destroyed. And Nanette talked about a kingdom earlier, yeah. A heavenly kingdom. Mm-hmm. You follow? One that's from above, not over there in the geographical Jerusalem.
Right.
Like many people literally think that Jesus is coming back and going to move in to a temple that they're trying to build or recreate to this day. You follow? Talking about the literalness of people's ignorance, of speaking about something they know not. Because you talking about, we read what you just read, please. Listen to what Daniel's saying is happening. Read.
And in the days of these kings shall the Lord of heaven set up a kingdom.
Now, Yahweh is going to set up a kingdom. I just got done telling you that Yahweh is Elohim, and he's going to set up a kingdom. Read.
Which shall never be destroyed.
Uh-huh.
And the kingdom shall not be left to other people.
Not going to be left to other people. It's not going to be, the concepts of man's opinion about this kingdom. It's not going to be a kingdom on earth like the Jehovah Witnesses believe. Mm-hmm. But keep reading.
But it shall break in pieces and consume all these kingdoms, and it shall stand forever.
Mm-hmm.
For as much as thou sawest that the stone was cut out of the mountain.
Now this stone is going to be cut out of the mountain without hands. Mm-hmm. Nanette talked about us about a circumcision made without hands. Hey, Moses, when he went up atop Mount Sinai, took a stone from out of the mountain, made without hands. Yahshua the Messiah, when he talked to the woman, and he stooped down and wrote in that sand, he's writing in stone, fulfilling this that he took out of this mountain. Mm-hmm. You follow? Now, when we understand that this stone is Yahweh, and he's building himself a kingdom that's not on earth, but is above, we have to understand this. Nanette talked about a law that's going to be written in your heart and mind. Not out of a book, not out of the new so-called New Testament portion of your Bible. We're not talking about that. We're talking about an understanding in order for a veil to be rent. Just like that veil that Yahshua, when he gave up the ghost, written twain in that temple. Because that's a physical temple that was destroyed. It was destroyed three times. And now they're trying to rear it up again. Not understanding the precepts and the principles. They don't understand the milk about this Elohim that Daniel even writes about through the inspiration of Yahweh. Letting Daniel know what to write. Daniel don't know nothing about no Elohim coming from heaven. And that this stone's going to shatter these kingdoms. He's going to shatter our consciousness or rip our veils in order for us to be shown Yahweh Elohim. See, that's what this second coming is that we have written on here. More appropriately, the universal revelation of Yahshua the Messiah. See, Yahshua has already come. He's not coming. He's already came on the day of Pentecost into the hearts and minds of men. What this is talking about, Yahshua's second coming, is talking about Yahshua being revealed. You see, being revealed is different than coming out of the sky. He's already here. The thing is, we can't see him. We don't know him in the state and condition he's going to reveal himself as, that no man knows. You follow? And that's not Armageddon either. I'm not scaring nobody about anything. I'm just talking about a state and condition in order to be revealed. And somebody's going to see him. And when I'm talking about that somebody are them stones back there in Peter, good, that's going to see. Go back to Peter, please. Because Peter, go back up to where you could pick up them stones. Because it's got stones, plural. I just went back to Daniel talking about a stone singular that's going to destroy these kingdoms in the image of man. You follow? Through the various kingdoms that mankind has set up and established. And now we're going to have Peter talking about some stones. Read.
To whom coming as unto...
To whom's coming? Remember, Daniel talked about a stone that's going to come from out of heaven that's going to shatter that image or those kingdoms. Now, Peter's talking about somebody that's coming. Read.
To whom coming as unto a living stone.
Into a living stone. Read.
Disallowed indeed of men.
Disallowed of men, because we just got done reading Daniel talking about mankind ain't going to have no part of this heaven, no part of this kingdom. But keep reading.
But chosen of Yahweh and precious.
That's right.
Ye also as lively stones.
You also as lively stones that know the gospel of Yahshua Messiah, that know the milk and the precepts, line upon line, precept upon precept, having been made to understand the gospel. Now you're going to be lively stones coming from that stone that was instituted back there in the prophets or in the law or in the scriptures. And now we can go back here and understand what this stone was representing that Daniel's talking about. Because now we're learning about Yahshua the Messiah, you see. Yeah, he said Elohim. I get it. But that is Yahshua the Messiah. This is all pertaining to Yahshua the Messiah. Having come down and taken on a purpose in order for us to see and be revealed. You see, these things are all being revealed. John wrote Revelation. There's only one revelation, and that's the revelation of Yahshua the Messiah.
Right.
Now, we couched it in metaphors, similes, analogies, and various different kinds of lions with wings, leopards with wings, ten crowns on a beast, bears with ribs in his mouth, lions with crowns on his head, dragons even, scary red dragons even. All of these things are imagery about Yahshua the Messiah and his sidekick, Lucifer. Yes, sir. See, Dr. Kennedy said, hey, he's an ally to him, him being Dr. Kennedy at the then known time, but a hindrance or a problem to us because we can't see, can't discern. That's what our seventh aim is, I believe, to help you discern. And follow? Nevertheless, from out of this stone, going to produce lively stones. Keep reading.
Ye also, as lively stones, are built up a spiritual house.
Now you're building up a spiritual house. Where at? How you build a spiritual house? Read. Talking about a kingdom. Read.
A holy priesthood to offer up spiritual sacrifices acceptable to Yahweh by Yahshua the Messiah.
Ministers giving what kind of sacrifices?
Spiritual sacrifices.
Spiritual sacrifices. Didn't they, did they give back spiritual sacrifices back here with this temple?
No.
This tabernacle? They gave turtle doves, bullocks, calves, and every other such beast at the then known time that was going to be acceptable as though it was acceptable. Mm-hmm. It was a stench unto Yahweh. But Yahweh saying he wants some sacrifices
and offerings that would is not.
These are sacrifices and offerings that Yahweh would is not back here. But now she just read that we're supposed to give some spiritual sacrifices.
That's right.
That's what he wants from his sons, who are ministers of the gospel of Yahshua the Messiah. That's all invisible. That's all having to understand what we're talking about. Therefore, when people say, oh, you're just saying the same thing that we saying in our church, you're just using a different name. Mm-hmm. I beg to differ.
Yeah.
I beg to differ. You stay here long enough, you never heard about that stone back there with Daniel being alive, yeah, being lively stones, as though this is that one stone of eternity, and we're coming back to eternity. And you see, these are all lively stones all around Yahshua the Messiah. You follow? And see these lively stones here coming from up out of this lake of fire, as it were? Because we're already in a lake of fire. But these stones are coming up. Because when Yahshua Messiah is revealed from heaven, remember, not a place, but a conscious understanding of Yahshua Messiah. And you got to be a lively stone to see. That's what the doom and gloom is going to be.
Mm-hmm.
I can't see what you're looking at for a period of time. I'm not going to go into that, but just keep reading there with Peter.
Wherefore, also, it is contained in the scripture.
Oh, it's contained where?
In the scripture.
In the scripture. Which scripture? Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John? Let's find it.
Nope.
Let's see what scripture.
Isaiah 28:16.
Oh. Peter talking about a scripture. There's some people in today's world that don't think the Bible's worth anything. Peter back there after the day of Pentecost is still going to scripture.
Right.
Let's read what that is, and then let's maybe go talk to Isaiah a little bit.
Behold, I lay in Zion a chief cornerstone.
In Zion I lay a chief cornerstone. Read.
Elect precious.
Elect and precious.
And he that believeth on him.
Now you gotta believe on him. For what?
Shall not be confounded.
Now, if you believe on that stone, you won't be confounded. Isaiah said that?
That's Isaiah.
You have it played it there? Let's
Isaiah
go.
Isaiah 28:16.
Let's go to Isaiah 28:16. That's right around 28:9-10.
Yep.
Uh-oh. Uh-oh. Uh-oh.
Isaiah 28:16.
Go up a little bit. I like to have a running start, because that's how we've been taught. Got to go up above the verse a little bit to get the continuity in order to get the thread or the theme. Now, we've already talked about it a little bit, but let's see what Isaiah talked about. This is what Peter said. Peter pulling this. Read.
14. Wherefore, hear the word of Yahweh, ye scornful men.
Oh, you scornful men that think that Jesus is a name. You scornful men that think that Yahweh's name is the Lord. Scornful men that deny the report. Read.
That rule this people which is in Jerusalem.
That rule this people. Now, Isaiah is only dealing with the children of Israel, mind you, because right. We went back to the scriptures. Mm-hmm. And now we go back to the scriptures, hopefully, to edify the person, letting them know that the Israelites were our example for us to learn from. That's why Isaiah is talking about them people. And those scornful people that denied the word of Yahweh were troubled, were confounded, were confused. They didn't know. What else Isaiah say?
Because ye have said, we have made a covenant with death, and with Sheol are we at agreement.
They agree. They're in death. They're in darkness. It was Sheol means death or the grave. Read.
When the overflowing scourge shall pass through it.
That scourge is going to pass through this darkness. Read.
It shall not come unto us.
Mm-hmm.
For we have made lies our refuge. And see, under falsehood have we hid ourselves.
See, that stone not going to come unto us or to them. Through that darkness, because they made lies and hypocrisy of the gospel. By purpose at this then known time. But this is what we're drawing forth from out of it, so we don't make the same mistake that they did back then. And we can rightly divide the word of truth. I'm dividing it by saying that Isaiah now is talking about the Israelites. And we can go back until they were in. We can go back from Isaiah to when they would come up out of Egypt. And see all the scornful things that they did.
Yeah.
Changing the name of Yahweh to Adonai. Not believing the report of what they saw. That Yahweh told them they had a land of Canaan to overtake. Coming back and giving a false report. Lying. Not believing. You follow?
Yep.
What else Isaiah say?
Therefore, thus saith Yahweh. Behold, I lay in Zion for a foundation, a stone.
Isaiah said it. He's talking about a stone. Daniel said it. He's talking about a stone. And what about that stone?
A tried stone, a precious cornerstone.
A tried stone. Well, that's tried, right? T-R-I-D. Tried. Being made.
Right.
Was made to be like this.
Mm-hmm.
They're talking about that stone. The spirit was made to be like this and to do what it did. Keep reading.
A sure foundation.
A sure foundation. Not a foundation on Peter, because you find some people in the community of theological understanding in religion and schools. They say that that stone was the stone of Peter back there in the, was that Rome?
Yeah.
On the cathedral. We might get there.
It was the actual Messiah.
Yes, it is.
It destroyed the Roman Empire.
It sure did. Sure enough. That Roman Empire or that cathedral they have back there. What's it called? The Roman.
Chapel.
All of that. Where they think that Peter was buried at. And believing on that Catholic faith have it'll come back to me. A tri-stone. Keep reading.
He that believeth shall not make haste.
Now you got to believe it and shall not make haste in order to know, in order to learn all you can about this stone or about Yahshua the Messiah. Read.
Judgment also will I lay to the line, and righteousness to the plummet.
Mm-hmm.
And the hail shall sweep away the refuge of lies, and the waters shall overflow the hiding place.
The waters shall overflow the hiding place. See, we also can pick up a pure river that come down. That pure river being allegorical to the gospel. Preaching to the ears of those who are trying to hide, trying to deny, trying to escape the wrath of the hail that she just talked about and all that that Yahweh does in order to evade the truth of the report. What else Isaac say?
And your covenant with death shall be disannulled.
See, that covenant of death are these carnal ordinances for the people. For the Jewish people, this was a covenant. And it was a covenant unto death. Because this is what they're trying to do back here with Isaiah. They're trying to fulfill these things. They're trying to do these things.
Until the time of Reformation.
Until the time of Yahshua the Messiah. To reform them from this. You follow? But as Isaiah is hitting them with it now. That this is their death. Read.
And your agreement with Sheol shall not stand.
See, this is an agreement with the grave until this day. Because they're trying to perform and do these works until this day. But it's an agreement unto death. Mm-hmm. Read.
When the overflowing scourge shall pass through, mm-hmm. then ye shall be trodden down by it.
That's the gospel. Going to trodden down your theories, concepts, and opinion about what you think this represents and what you think this is. That's the scourge that's coming. Keep reading.
From the time that it goeth forth, it shall take you from morning.
That scourge is from Pentecost going forward.
Yeah.
That's the scourge. The day of Pentecost started that. Read.
For morning by morning shall it pass over by day and by night.
Oh, it's been going on since the day of Pentecost. We talked about it. Read.
And ye will be terrified when he will make you to understand the vision.
Mm. You're going to have to be made to understand the vision.
Yep.
It's a vision that we have to understand. Not Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John in the context that we would be studious and sit down and try to memorize and be students like we were in our carnal way of thinking. Going to school and learning about Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, or the epistles, or Acts, and trying to put dates on them and think that we got some chronological know-how. And think that Jesus said this and Jesus said that, and I'm going to be good for Jesus' sake. No, we're talking about a vision. Yeah. Isaiah talking about a vision. Daniel had a vision. We're talking about a vision that Moses had, that John in Revelations had, and that our founder had in the year 1931, a panoramic vision about the whole kit and caboodle, if you would, right? Rightly dividing in order for us to become lively stones. Let's go back to Peter, please. Okay. You get the context. Peter went to Isaiah, We got that what Isaiah was talking about, and he's letting his people know, this Jews then know, about this scourge, about this water that's going to be coming. You follow?
Peter.
And you let them know that they're stones if they believe the report, because they've heard the report. Read.
8. And a stone of stumbling and a rock of offense.
See, Yahshua is a rock of offense. You say Yahshua's name too much to somebody, they get offended. No. He's a stumbling stone. This is a stumbling stone, who Yahshua is. That's why we asked the question. Who was that man that walked during the time the Palestinian right. Judean hills? Who was that man? Because people stumbling all over themselves thinking they know him. They don't know. And he's a rock of offense to the Gentiles and to the Jews. Because the Jews are the one who purported most of this stuff. That's a Jewish Bible. That's a Jewish book written in Hebrew. They drew out from Hebrew into Greek and then into Latin. Dr. Kenny talked about how they then took it from Judah, from Jerusalem, and brought it down through Alexander. Alexander's Greece. He brought it down to Egypt, to Athenia, I think it was, down here in Egypt. Where's it at? From Jerusalem here, when the great Alexander, they had that school in Alexandria. There you go, boss. In Alexandria, down here in Egypt. That's when they began to translate from that Hebrew into that Greek. And this is why you're going to get that translation. But it was originally in Hebrew. And that's why we go back to Hebrew, to the original names, to understand what it's all about. Because they were studying that book through and through.
The library was burned.
The library down here in Alexandria was burned. Mm-hmm. Okay. And so we're just letting you know that this book's been studied, but it's been also been translated. But it's been put back together as well. This is how we're able to preach the gospel of Yahshua Messiah. You follow? Keep reading.
Even to them which stumble at the word, being disobedient.
See, they're stumbling at the word. People say, why read the Bible if it's been manipulated and been changed and been altered? How do you know? They're stumbling over the names. They're stumbling over the dates. They're stumbling over the times. They don't know what's transpired because the book has been changed. It's a mystery now. It's always been a mystery. Mm-hmm. Yahweh having a vision is a vision. And he's saying, I will be what I will to be. I'll be your delusion, or I'll be your revelation. And he'll put you in either state and condition. And mind you, we've all come in through the delusion first.
Yeah.
Hook, line, and sinker.
Right.
Not a one. Even our founder came in initially through a delusion. And it's up to Yahweh It was by Yahweh that gives us the ability to be able to see his righteousness if we believe. Yes, Yahweh is in control.
Yes.
But yet you have a choice.
Yes.
Now I say that there's some contention about choice when I make that statement. That we choose or we don't have a choice. Because I was about to say that Yahweh put it all in a delusion first, right? But that's part of the purpose. The purpose is to come from out of that delusion, to see the reality of who and what he is, to have something to discern from.
Right.
If you just this, as it would be his will, would be one thing. That's what he did with Yahshua Messiah. That's why Yahshua Messiah knew he was going to get on this cross. He came in the likeness of sinful flesh. He was the only one that came in right, if you can say it that way. You follow? And because of the purpose, we have to discern and know. Otherwise, if we didn't have a choice, why are we discerning? Why did AIM say it? If we got a choice, number 7, can we read it?
Oh.
Do you have it? No. I'll read it. to discern and avoid being deceived. If it was already a choice and we already going to be saved, then there's no need to discern. There'll be no need to discern and to avoid anything. This is the aim, to discern and avoid being deceived by Lucifer. And if you already going to have a choice and you good and you righteous, there'll be no need to extirpate anything, because you would already know what superstition is. You would already know what skepticism is. You would already know these things. You wouldn't be glum or depressed over anything. You wouldn't be struggling. It was just a choice. You don't need to investigate. It was just a choice. If you just know, no need to investigate nothing. Why investigate? Why have an aim for anything? Why aim? Why any of them aims? Why I even? Nothing. Why contend? You know what? It's peace. Why contend for a common salvation that was once given to man? And they didn't pick it up either. See, Yahshua Messiah had to go back in the graves while they were in repose in order to be brought out of that state and condition. You follow? And therefore, it is the same with us, because, hey, yet he come in for the whole world then, that first 4,000 years, and picked them up and brought them out of their graves as first fruits. That's another allegorical expression to Yahshua the Messiah. Just like that stone is. You have that first fruit, right. Yahshua Messiah, and then he have fruits that come up after him. He's that stone of stumbling, and then he has stones that's coming, preaching the gospel of Yahshua Messiah, that you're going to stumble on just as well. For those who've been made by the milk, and read it line upon line, and precept upon precept. Right. See, you're not going to escape Yahshua Messiah, because he's already concluded this end too. That's what there's no choice about.
True.
That's what there's no choice about.
True.
Yahshua had already fulfilled it and already finished it.
Already.
But with a hope, it's a hope in order to see the revelation of Yahshua Messiah. Mm-hmm. Therefore, you have to learn and know. If it was a choice to know, you would have to learn nothing about Yahshua Messiah. You got to have to change. You had to be converted or reconciled unto Yahshua Messiah. You got to do that. You got to believe. If it was just a choice, you had to believe in nothing. Therefore, you got to believe and know that who Yahshua Messiah is, according to the report, not your opinion, your concept, or your theory. That's the problem. People got a whole world of that. Someone wrote there's some 45,000 denominations amongst the world. All different ideas from primarily the Bible, and then subsequently the Mormon Bible, and any other thing that anybody wrote, the Quran included. All a concept, all a theory, all an opinion derived from out of the scriptures. I'll say it out of the scriptures, mm-hmm. because the Quran, they dig in Moses.
Right. That's right.
The Quran dig in Moses. Mormon, they dig in Moses. Mm-hmm. Every known people love Moses. Even Yahshua Messiah said, in Moses in whom you love or whom you believe. Either way, you say it either way. They believe him. They love Moses. Moses was a meek man. So they say.
You believe Moses, you believe me.
That's right. You believe Moses. They should believe him. But they didn't, and they don't. Mm. Right? So this is what we're learning about how to discern and avoid being deceived by Lucifer. Or this dragon, or Satan and his demons, whichever way you want to put it. But we're talking about Peter talking to his boys at the then known time.
Mm-hmm. Whereunto also they were appointed,
mm-hmm.
but ye are a chosen generation.
Now look, he said that they were appointed. Prophets were appointed. Moses was appointed. Adam was appointed. Abel was appointed. They were appointed. By Yahshua the Messiah.
Mm-hmm.
All the way until their present time. Until the cross. John the Baptist was appointed. Having the Holy Spirit in him for a period of time was appointed. But see, he had to forget who he was and what he was and what he said when he baptized Yahshua the Messiah. Even he told his boys, talking about John the Baptist, told his boys to go ask Yahshua, are you really the Messiah in whom we should be looking for? He didn't know. Then when he was in jail, that's correct. See, he was appointed. Spirit being in the body, and now the spirit out of the body. And I just got done saying that Yahshua, when he was in that burial tomb of Joseph's new tomb, he went back and picked them all up, mm-hmm. preaching to them, showing them the report. So we're not worried about them. We got to worry about ourselves. Now, what's he saying about ourselves? Peter, this is Peter now. He said they were appointed in what?
A royal priesthood.
Go back to where he said they were appointed.
But you, oh, okay. Whereunto also they were appointed.
They were appointed, read.
But ye are a chosen
generation.
But you are
a chosen generation.
A royal priesthood.
Okay.
A holy nation.
Mm-hmm.
A peculiar people.
Mm-hmm.
That ye should show forth the praises of him who hath called you out of darkness into his marvelous light.
That's what Yahshua is telling them. The children of it, the Jews at the then known time, they were going to be a priesthood. Because remember, Yahshua Messiah said that this gospel shall be preached. I need it. Matthew 24 chapter. So he's telling them about a priesthood, about a peculiar people. See, that's what he did with the children of Israel. That's what we got to this Second Peter about a peculiar people. But he's not talking about those Jews back here at this particular time. He's talking about those sons that are receiving the report that he's teaching them. And he's teaching those Jews first. And I want to get down to where it says about this kingdom should be preached first in Jerusalem, then in Samaria.
And that's in 24 and?
I believe so.
Well, Matthew 24:14 about the gospel shall be preached in the kingdom.
I understand that.
Okay. You want up further? Oh, I think I know.
Give me Romans 1:16. It's good enough. Joshua says it too.
Yeah.
But give me Romans 1:16 first, and then we'll.
Yeah. Romans 1:16. For I am not ashamed of the gospel of the Messiah, for it is the power of Yahweh unto salvation to everyone that believeth, to the Jews first, and also to the Gentiles.
Now, this is why I went back there to pick up a little something. That's showing that it has to be preached to the Jews first. I think it's Acts. Maybe Acts 1. Read down through Acts 1. But see, you have Saul speaking about to the Jews first. Hold on. Jews first. So he's speaking to the Jews first. That's why he's telling them they were a peculiar nation, a peculiar people. And Peter's a Hebrew, trying to let his Hebrew people know that they were a peculiar people back here in Egypt. And that these were the people that Yahweh chose in order to perform this migration into this promised land. And this is going to be allegorical to this kingdom that's from heaven. This is the literalness of it. And now Peter's expressing the reality of it. And what we're expressing is that he's speaking to the Jews first, because this is a gospel or a report that has to be taught and preached. That's why you have so many churches and so many people with so many different gospels. And this is what we're having to learn to discern how and why. Now, I'm just putting it together how Peter's talking about it, how Peter went back to the Jews first. That's why he told them to you first. Because you were a peculiar people. And it was first made known to you. Yahshua told him, Saul tells him right after he makes this statement in Romans 1:19-20, to them. Who them? Them Israelites. They had Elohim with them. They did the service. But it was not made known to them. Peter is now making it clear, letting them know about this stone of stumbling. And that what this is all about, what their fathers had to do. You follow?
Yeah.
Why the prophets? Why Moses going up into this mount? You follow?
Mm-hmm.
Why did they spend 40 years? All of these things Peter's revealing to the Israel. We read Stephen on Tuesday.
Right.
Ran down, Stephen banging on him all the way from this burning bush, brought him all the way down and brought him all the way back up out of here by the gospel, by the preaching. And this is what Peter's telling the Jews then on the fifth dispensation about why you're ministers of a gospel and having to need milk and having to understand this thing line upon line, precept upon precept. This is why we go over this over and over again. To get the continuity, to have some faith in the report, which is spiritual, which is a vision, which is a reality that we have to live by going forward. You follow? What I have you get?
Oh, Acts.
You see it there in Acts?
Acts 1:7.
I think so.
And he said unto them, it is not for you to know the times or the season, which the Father has put in his own power.
This is Yahshua, having had resurrected and showing himself to whomever he showed himself to, mind you. He's raised a quickening spirit already, and they're seeing him. And he's speaking to them. What's he saying?
But ye shall receive power after the Holy Spirit has come upon you.
Uh-huh.
And ye shall be witnesses unto me.
They're going to be witnesses unto me, unto the Spirit. Read.
Both in Jerusalem. And all Judea.
And in Samaria.
And to the uttermost part of the earth.
And that's what we're doing now, to the uttermost parts of the earth, about the gospel of Yahshua Messiah. You follow? He says it another place before he takes off the flesh, about Jews first, then Samaria, picking up those tribes, as you would. They call lost tribe, but they was never lost. They were just there for an appointed time, and then the uttermost parts of the world. And that's what we're doing now. You follow? Back to Peter. See, Peter there is not talking to us people here, if I could say it that way. He's speaking to the Jews first.
10, which in time past were not a people, but are now the people of Yahweh.
See, these people back here was a time. He's letting him know that those people, after Pentecost, he's letting them know that those people, your fathers, your ancestors, as it were, were for a period of time. And this is what they went through. But now we're a different people. Reread what you just read. Read.
Which in time past were not a people,
uh-huh,
but are now the people of Yahweh.
Okay.
Which had not obtained mercy, but now have obtained mercy.
See, they didn't obtain mercy back here. Why? Because they were following a covenant, a first covenant, the Ten Commandments, and other 613 judgment statutes and ordinances. 603. You include the 10 in that 613. You follow? And then now they didn't receive squat other than what their purpose was for. Now what? Keep reading.
Dearly beloved,
mm-hmm,
I beseech you as strangers and pilgrims,
mm-hmm,
abstain from fleshly lusts which war against the soul.
The concepts, the theories, and opinions that war against your soul. Read.
Having your conduct honest among the heathens,
mm-hmm,
that whereas they speak against you as evildoers,
mm-hmm,
they may be your good works, which they shall behold.
Now, you might do good and deal with the people in a good way, and there's no problem with that. That's the least you should be doing.
Right.
You follow?
Right.
Having the nature or the conduct or being an ambassador of the gospel of Yahshua Messiah in order to win souls and to preach to souls. Read.
Which they shall behold glorify Yahweh in the day of visitation.
Mm-hmm.
Submit yourselves to every ordinance of man for Yahweh's sake.
That's mean follow the signs, follow the rules, if you would. Don't get in no trouble, if you would. Being an ambassador, being available to preach the gospel. Read.
Whether it be to the king as supreme, mm-hmm. or unto governors as unto them that are sent by him for the punishment of evildoers and for the praise of them that do well. For so is the will of Yahweh, that with well-doing ye may put to silence the ignorance of foolish men.
As see, we with this gospel, this is what we hope to do, is to eradicate the ignorance of foolish men. Rightly dividing the word of truth and imparting the gospel to somebody that don't know. Because we're not mad at people. We've made that statement time and time again. Come one, come all. Reggie used to say, bring your friends and your enemies. Yeah. Have no problem with that. Bring them.
Yeah.
Act mindful. Be respectful. But come with an open heart and an open mind whereby you can learn something. Be it milk or be it some meat. But learn something about your Heavenly Father. This is what we do. You follow? Once you have the veil of your consciousness revealed. And again, ain't no one telling you to do anything or act a certain way or be a certain way. The gospel does that. The gospel converts and changes. As Nanette talked about, it's done without hands, it's done without having been written in any book. It's done by the hearing and the seeing according to our consciousness about the truth. Keep reading Peter a little bit more. I'm about exhausted with that.
Free and not using your liberty for a cloak of maliciousness.
Uh-oh.
But as the servants of Yahweh.
Mm-hmm.
Honor all men. Love the brotherhood. Fear Yahweh. Honor the king.
Mm-hmm.
Servants, be subject to your masters with all fear, not only to the good and gentle, but also to the froward.
Mm-hmm.
For this is thankworthy if a man for conscience towards Yahweh endure grief, suffering wrongfully. For what glory is it if when ye be buffeted for your faults, ye shall take it patiently. But if when ye do well and suffer for it, ye take it patiently, this is acceptable with Yahweh. For even hereunto were ye called, because the Messiah also suffered for us, leaving us an example that ye should follow his steps. Who did not sin, neither was gall found in his mouth.
Mm-hmm.
Who, when he was reviled, reviled not again. When he suffered, he threatened not, but committed himself to him that judged righteously.
Mm-hmm.
Who his own self bare our sins in his own body on the tree, that we, being dead to sin, should live unto righteousness, by whose stripes ye were healed.
Now he's talking merely about all these things that went on through the children of Israel. This is what Yahshua did for us, you follow? So that we now, Gentiles as it were, can look back to see this man, Yahshua the Messiah, and what he performed for some 3.5 years, you follow? And mind you, that some 4,000 years, because he came in by the fall of Adam, because it's the conscience of the man's mind that we're looking to convert, if you would. A consciousness, one, about Yahshua the Messiah, Because Yah said after that, after the conscience is subdued, then you have that law being written in your heart and mind, as Net talked about. You follow? The law of patience. Law of intelligence, knowledge. The attributes begin to take up a righteous formation in your conduct and in your being. You don't need a man to tell you what to do or not to do. But you do it according to pleasing Yahweh. You follow? By understanding Yahshua the Messiah. It's as simple as that. It's as simple as learning how to a doctor. He just don't jump up. He might jump up and say, hey, I want to be a heart surgeon. He begin, but he don't go into no surgery room just because he woke up in the morning and said, I want to be a heart surgeon. He got to go to school. He has to learn. And over a certain amount of, I would presume, some technical training to go into a man's heart or a brain surgeon or any difficult surgery, and they all can be difficult. People go in for a simple procedure and don't ever come out sometimes when you don't know how to go into that particular body, right? So you want to be able to go into the gospel much the same way and be able to understand how to do. And over time, it becomes natural. It becomes a skill set, whatever that doctor's modality is, they're able to perform it. And you can let go, and they have the music playing, and they just going in there, and it's like an orchestra when they go into those different bodies. Certain film documentaries show how they go into those technical surgeries. Doctors coming in loose and goose and fresh, got headphones on, music is playing, but you wouldn't know how to do a thing that they're doing. But they've come to have that skill to do that. But they had to learn, and then it becomes natural. And then you have to take on that nature of that spirit, and you believe in that, because he had to believe in what they're doing. All his cohorts around them, they had to believe in the project that they're at or the surgery that they're performing. It's a beautiful thing. But we're dealing with a conscience. Yeah, go ahead.
For ye were as sheep going astray, but are now returned unto the shepherd and bishop of your souls.
Now that's Peter speaking to those that know, those that have heard the report. And there was certainly a report read, 1 Corinthians 15th chapter. Mm-hmm. Talking about a report.
Moreover, brethren, I declared unto you the gospel which I preached unto you, which also you have received, and wherein you stand, by which also ye are saved, if ye keep in memory what I preached unto you, unless ye have believed in vain.
See right there, John let him know there's a report that he's been preached, unless they believe in vain, meaning for not. Hey, keep reading one more time.
For I delivered unto you, first of all, that which I also received. How that Yahshua died for our sins according to the scriptures.
That's good. So we're letting him know that there was a report that they've had. And Peter's talking to this, to the like-minded Hebrews at the same time about this report. After this day of Pentecost that went out about Yahshua the Messiah. You follow? And that's what they heard. And unless they believed in vain is what we don't want to miss and misconstrue. What do I mean by that? We talked about a stone. We talked about a veil that needs to be ripped in twain to in order to perceive the things of Yahweh. Because that's what he said. Man could not perceive, right, in this pure spirit state. So therefore, we should be perceiving something, seeing something, understanding something. That's what Annette's testimony was about, wanting to be able to see clearly and understand clearly and know clearly for herself, right? And it's all for ourselves, because I can't get in anywhere to see anything on anybody else's coattail. You follow? It's also been said, every tub has to stand on its own bottom, right? Proof in point, John 8:4. Talking about the stone, because I already mentioned it earlier.
John 8:4.
This is Yahshua. This is John writing about what happened to Yahshua years past. Follow? Before he was hung on the cross, in an old age, or in the third age, as it were, right? This is in a fourth dispensation. This is John reflecting, if you would, about what Yahshua went through and had to deal with these scribes and Pharisees, that peculiar people, as it were, that didn't know who Yahshua was. Now, this is what Yahshua had did.
John 8:4. They say unto him, Rabbi, this woman.
Go up to three. Yep.
And the scribe and Pharisees brought unto him a woman taken in adultery.
Now we know what the gist is. You got scribes and Pharisees upset with this woman because of this law back here. You follow? This is a law that they upset about, and they bringing this woman to Yahshua, who is going to see what he has to say about it. Right?
And when they had set her in the midst, they say unto him, Rabbi, this woman was taken in adultery in the very act.
Because that was a commandment. Nanette talked about it, that when that law, when they come up out of Egypt and they tear here on the June the 6th, 50 days after coming up out of Egypt, that was part of the commandment. Thou shalt not commit adultery. That's a problem. It's a problem to a lot of people until this day. And their conscience wears on them about that act. You follow? But keep reading.
Now Moses and the law commanded us that such should be stoned. But what sayest thou?
See, they talking about this law. The law that Moses said. What do you say about this, buddy? Read.
This they said, tempting him that they might have to accuse him.
Mm-hmm.
But Yahshua stooped down with his finger, wrote on the ground.
Now he's writing on this ground. Yahshua stooped down.
Mm-hmm.
Let's go.
But when they continued asking him, he lifted up himself and said unto them, he that is without sin among you, let him be the first to cast a stone at her.
See, he wrote down, he stooped down the first time. Guess him fulfilling this second trip into the mountain, and Moses bringing down this stone here. This is the stone that Yahshua is fulfilling right now, and because we know what happens with this first set of stones that Moses brought down on his second trip into the mountain. Yes. He breaks them because he's asking them who don't have some sin or some problem. Let them cast the first stone. Mm-hmm. Then Moses cast the stone. Keep reading.
Mm-hmm. And again, he stooped down.
Now he went down again and stooped down again. Why? Because Moses, on the 34th chapter of Exodus, he has to bring out another stone. Moses has to hew out a set of stone and bring it up into this mountain. And when you go back to that story, Moses writes on that stone again. He sure does. Why? Because Yahshua Messiah is fulfilling this next verse. Read.
And they which hear it, being convicted by their own conscience, went out one by one, being
Stooped down again.
Uh-huh. He stooped down and wrote on the ground.
That's what I wanted to get. He wrote again. That's because Yahshua wrote again in this heart of mind of Moses, in the stone that Moses brought up, he wrote again these 10 laws, right? Mm-hmm. Read. Now read.
And they which heard it, being convicted by their own conscience, went out one by one, being at the eldest, even unto the last.
All of them.
And Yahshua was left alone, and the woman standing in the midst.
See, no stones was thrown then. And read.
When Yahshua had lifted up himself and saw none but the woman, he said unto her, Woman, where are those thine accusers? Hath not no man condemned thee? She said, No man, sire. And Yahshua said unto her, Neither do I condemn thee. Go and sin no more. Then spake Yahshua again unto them, saying, I am the light of the world. He that followeth me shall not walk in darkness, but shall have the light of life.
Now he's going to have the light of life to them that follow him, right? I'm going to need Romans 8 and 1. This is what Yahshua is fulfilling. This is what Yahshua is coming to do. That act of riding and stooping down is a fulfillment showing that he is the one ordained to come in as an outcast, as a in the likeness of sinful flesh, in order to fulfill everything according to the law, so that that law is not on us anymore to perform or have our conscience perverted and ignorant about who and what he is, so that we can have that light that he just talked about, that what it was that's going to light every man, right? Now keep reading.
Romans 8:1.
Mm-hmm.
There is therefore now no condemnation.
Now that condemnation that those men had when he was talking about that adultery, you ought not have that no more after the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. But keep reading.
To them which are in Yahshua the Messiah.
Now you got to be in Yahshua. Elohim got to be with you. You follow? In you. But you have to understand it. You have to see it. He has to remove that veil. And it's without hands. It's without doing anything. It's the grace. It's the free gift. It's not a work of a law. But it's a gift of an understanding and a perceiving. And that's what we hope. That's why we pray. That we pray the prayer for understanding and knowing Yahweh's purpose. Keep reading.
Who walk not after the flesh, but after the spirit.
We don't walk after the carnal ordinances anymore that Nanette talked about earlier. We don't deal with those literal physical things, as it were. Read.
For the law of the spirit of life in Yahshua the Messiah.
See, there's a law of the spirit of life that is with Yahshua the Messiah.
Has made me free from the law of sin and death.
This is the law of the sin. And I just said, we had said earlier, a while back, that that law, or the Ten Commandment law, or the judgment of the ordinances and judgments and the law of Moses, was a law of death, a law of Sheol. Isaiah said it was. Over there in the 28th chapter of Isaiah, he said it was. And it was a law of sin and death that Saul is expressing now, letting his people know that that's a law of sin and death. You're not to do that, but it's of the spirit. Keep reading, please.
For what the law could not do, in that it was weak through the flesh, Yahweh sent in his own son in the likeness of sinful flesh because of sin to condemn sin in the flesh.
Mm-hmm.
That the righteousness of the law might be fulfilled in us.
See, if the righteousness of the law may be fulfilled, what law? Yahshua already fulfilled that law. But the law that we have to fulfill it, is now being done. And that's learning about Yahshua the Messiah. And when you learn about him, you're fulfilling that law that you set up and don't understand where and what you're doing. The fulfilling is still going on. It's being fulfilled or being revealed who Yahshua is. That's how we become stones. That's how we become fruits. That's how we become ministers of the Holy Spirit. Keep reading.
Mm-hmm. Who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. Mm-hmm. For they that are after the flesh do mind the things of the flesh, but they that are after the Spirit, the things of the Spirit.
Mm-hmm.
For to be carnally minded is death.
Now, to be carnally minded is death. We're past that now.
But to be spiritually minded is life and peace.
Skip down to 26. For my time is short.
Likewise, the Spirit also helpeth our infirmities.
Mm-hmm.
For we know not what we should pray for as we ought.
Mm-hmm.
But the Spirit itself maketh intercession for us with groanings which cannot be uttered.
That's what Yahshua does for us when we pray and reach out. We know how to pray. He's talking, remember, he's talking to a people that's just now learning about Yahshua the Messiah and who and what he is. But we now know, we've done had a panoramic vision about all this. We know what we're praying about. We're not giving our sons and daughters serpents and snakes and things of that nature that it talks about in the scriptures that Yahshua said that that's what they give them. But nonetheless, let's keep reading right quick.
And he that searcheth the heart knoweth what is the mind of the Spirit,
mm-hmm.
because he maketh intercession for the sons according to the will of Yahweh.
That's Yahshua searching the heart and mind of the sons of Yahweh. Read.
And we know that all things work together for good to them that love Yahweh,
mm-hmm.
to them who are the called according to his purpose,
mm-hmm.
for whom he did foreknow. He also did predestine.
That's Yah. That's going back to no choice. He already foreknew him in the realm of eternity, having your name written in this book, predestined to do what we do and how we do. Keep reading.
To be conformed to the image of his son.
See, now we're being conformed or changed. Why? Because now we know something about Yahshua Messiah, the truth about Yahshua Messiah, which is the Holy Spirit being in you, your hope, our hope and glory. Keep reading.
That he might be the firstborn among many brethren.
So now you're going to be a firstborn among many brethren. Read.
Moreover, when he did predestine, them he also called.
Uh-huh.
And whom he called, them he also justified. And whom he justified, them he also glorified.
Mm-hmm. Keep reading.
What shall we then say to these things? If Yahweh be for us, who can be against us? He that spared not his own son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him also freely give us all things?
Skip down to 35.
Who shall separate us from the love of the Messiah?
I mean, you can't bring in no new gospel, no new truth, no new denomination, no new words of wisdom or witchcraft or any such thing. Read.
Shall tribulation or distress or persecution
mm-hmm.
or famine or nakedness or peril or sword?
Mm-hmm.
As it is written, for thy sake are we killed all the day long. We are accounted as sheep for the slaughter.
Mm-hmm.
Nay, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him that loved us. For I am persuaded that neither death nor life nor angels nor principalities nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of Yahweh, which is in Yahshua the Messiah, our Savior.
Hallelujah. If you got anything out of tonight's class, all praises to Yahweh our Elohim by way of Yahshua the Messiah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
This concludes this evening's workshop. Are there any announcements? We hold classes here in Ontario, California on Tuesdays and Thursdays from 7:30 p.m. to 9:30 p.m. and Sundays from 11 a.m. to 1 p.m. Please bring your enemies and friends. This is the place to learn about our Heavenly Father. Let's all stand and be dismissed with the doxology taken from the last two verses of the book of Jude. Now unto him that is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy. To the only wise Elohim, our Savior, through Yahshua the Messiah, our Sovereign, belong glory and majesty, dominion and power, both before all time and now and forever. Let's all say hallelujah.